Chapter 31. Cyrus, King of Persia. Thus saith the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have holden to subdue nations before him, and I will loose the loins of kings, to open before him the two leaved gates, and the gates shall not be shut. Isaiah 45:1. 7 years after Nebuchadnezzar's death, Nabonidus, the first archaeologist, ascended the throne of Babylon in 555 B.C. He was to be the last ruler from Mesopotamia. For events in the highlands of Iran suggested that world history was quickly heading for a great revolution. 5 years after the ascension of Nabonidus, the new era began with the Persians' rise to power. The Medes, who since the fall of Nineveh in 612 B.C., had shared the stricken Assyrian Empire with the Babylonians, were unexpectedly overcome by their neighbors and vassals, the Persians. Astyages, king of the Medes, was beaten by his own grandson, Cyrus. In the ancient world, great men were wont to herald their arrival in extraordinary ways. Often, the remarkable circumstances of their birth took them outside the normal framework of the lives of their contemporaries. Two unusual dreams are said to have decided the destiny of Cyrus. They were gossiped around the whole of the ancient Orient, and in this way came to the ears of Herodotus, who recounts them. Astyages had a daughter who was named Mandane. He dreamt that from her such a stream of water flowed forth as not only to fill his capital, but to flood the whole of Asia. This vision he laid before such of the magi as had the gift of interpreting dreams, who expounded its meaning to him in full, whereat he was greatly terrified. On this account, when his daughter was of marriageable age, he would not give her to any of the Medes lest the dream should be accomplished, but married her to a Persian by the name of Cambyses. When Mandane was living with Cambyses, Astyages, in the very first year, saw another vision. He fancied that a vine grew from the womb of his daughter and overshadowed the whole of Asia. After this dream, which he submitted also to the interpreters, he sent to Persia and fetched away Mandane, who was now with child and was not far from her time. On her arrival, he set a watch over her, intending to destroy the child to which she should give birth. For the Magian interpreters had expounded the vision to foreshow that the offspring of his daughter would reign over Asia in his stead. To guard against this, Astyages, as soon as Cyrus was born, sent for Harpagus, a man of his own house and the most faithful of the Medes, and addressed him thus, "Take the child born of Mandane, carry him with thee to thy home, and slay him there." Harpagus found that he had no heart to carry out this murderous command of the child's grandfather. No more had a shepherd to whom he disputed the task, so Cyrus remained alive. It was not only the birth and boyhood of Cyrus that were wrapped in legend. This Persian king's son descended from the royal race of Achaemenes, has more than any other prince of the ancient world caught the imagination and evoked the admiration of all nations. Xenophon, the Greek, celebrated the foundation of his empire in a complete romance, the Cyropedia. The Bible remembers him as an enlightened monarch. His unparalleled, swift, and brilliant rise to power was marred by no deed of violence. His able and humane policy made him one of the most attractive figures in the ancient Orient. The most repugnant feature of Oriental monarchs before him, despotic cruelty, was foreign to this Persian. The figure of Cyrus became a hard fact of history in 553 B.C. To that year he captured Ecbatana, capital of the kingdom of Media. His royal grandfather, Astyages, was banished. Cyrus amalgamated Media with the Persian kingdom. Babylonia, Lydia in Asia Minor, and Sparta formed an alliance against the conqueror. Croesus, king of Lydia, his name is still proverbial for great riches, attacked the Persians. Cyrus took Sardis, his capital, and defeated him. The way to Babylonia was open, and Babylon lay invitingly before him. Against the background of such a situation, a strange and mysterious story got about which, since it has been recorded in the Bible, has gripped the imagination of the Western world. Belshazzar, the king, made a great feast to 1,000 of his lords and drank wine before 1,000. They drank wine and praised the gods of gold and of silver, of brass, of iron, of wood, and of stone. In the same hour came forth fingers of a man's hand, and wrote over against the candlestick upon which the plaster of the wall of the king's palace. Then the king's countenance was changed, and his thoughts troubled him, so that the joints of his loins were loosed, and his knees smote one against another. And the king spake, and said to the wise men of Babylon, "Whosoever shall read this writing, and show me the interpretation thereof, shall be clothed with scarlet, and have a chain of gold about his neck, and shall be the third ruler in the kingdom." Daniel 5:1-4-7. Mean, tekel upharsin, were the words on the wall which have become famous. They mean, "God hath numbered thy kingdom. Thou art weighed in the balances and art found wanting. Thy kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and Persians." Daniel 5:25-28. When Joseph in Egypt was able to interpret Pharaoh's dreams of the 7 fat kine and the 7 lean kine and of the ears of corn, he was made second man in the kingdom, grand vizier. What was the meaning of the promised reward for guessing the meaning of the mysterious writing to be the third ruler in the kingdom? This biblical statement was unintelligible and was only explained with the help of archaeology. Who Belshazzar was has now been established by cuneiform text from his own father. He was not, in fact, as the book of Daniel says, 5:2, the son of Nebuchadnezzar, but of Nabonidus, who says in an inscription, "And put into the heart of Belshazzar, my firstborn son, the fruit of my loins, fear of thy sublime divinity, that he commit no sin, and that he may have fullness of life." Thus it is clear that Belshazzar was crown prince, therefore the second man in Babylonia. He could only, therefore, hold out a promise of third highest place in the kingdom. The story of Belshazzar's feast and the writing on the wall reflects, through the eyes of the prophets, a contemporary political situation. In 539 BC, Cyrus turned his attack against Nabonidus, and the Babylonian army was defeated. With that, the hours of the last great Mesopotamian empire were numbered. "Come down and sit in the dust, O virgin daughter of Babylon. There is no throne, O daughter of the Chaldeans." Isaiah 47:1. A year after the battle, Cyrus, king of Persia, made his triumphal entry into the conquered Babylon. Hittites, Kassites, Assyrians had at various times threatened the great city with the same fate. This conquest, however, did not follow the normal pattern. It was without a parallel in the military practice of the ancient Orient. For this time, there were no columns of smoke rising from behind shattered walls, no temples or palaces razed to the ground, no house plundered, no man was butchered or impaled. The clay cylinder of Cyrus narrates in Babylonian script what took place. "As I entered Babylon in peace and established my royal residence in the palace of the princes amid jubilation and rejoicing, Marduk, the great lord, warmed the hearts of the Babylonians towards me, while I, for my part, devoted myself daily to do him reverence. My troops wandered peacefully, widespread throughout Babylon. In all Sumer and Akkad, I let no man be afraid. I concern myself with the internal affairs of Babylon and all its cities. The dwellers in Babylon I freed from the yoke that ill became them. I repaired their houses. I healed their afflictions. I am Cyrus, king of all, the great king, the mighty king, king of Babylon, king of Sumer, and Akkad, king of the four corners of the earth. The last sentences almost suggest that the biblical chronicler had known the text of the clay cylinder. Thus saith Cyrus, king of Persia, all the kingdoms of the earth hath the Lord God of heaven given me. 2 Chronicles 36:23. That rulers should make tolerance, including religious tolerance, their motto was uncommon and marked the Persian king out from the first. After the entry into Babylon, Cyrus at once had the images and shrines of the local gods set up again. He was concerned with the daily worship of the chief god of the city, Marduk. In the city of Ur, he did the same. One broken cylinder, which was preserved among the ruins, Cyrus himself says, Sin, the light of heaven and earth, with his favorable omens, gave into my hands the four corners of the earth. I brought the gods back into their sanctuaries. His tolerance was also to the advantage of the Jews. After these many years of exile, their dearest wish was now to find fulfillment.